Again, my name is Chung Shil Jenny Lee, visiting assistant professor of Korean art and visual culture in the Kress Foundation Department of Art History in KU. The final session of the conference is titled Chaekgeori for the People. As the title indicates, the presenters will discuss Chaekgeori in its process of popularization in folk art and culture during the late Joseon period. Our first presenter is Dr. Sunglim Kim, assistant professor of Asian and Middle Eastern Studies program at Dartmouth College. She got her MA in here, in this department, and PhD from UC Berkeley. Dr. Kim's focus of research is consumption and distribution and production and also a collection of art during the 18th and 19th century Joseon. And her first book will be soon to be published in the Washington University of Washington Press. So congrats. And let's see, Dr. Kim is a co-organizer of this traveling exhibition and also co-editor of the English version of the exhibition catalog. And her talk today will discuss titled Chaekgeori Screen from a Painter's Perspective. Our second presenter is Eleanor Hyun, curator of the Korean collections at the British Museum, and she is a PhD candidate at the University of Chicago. Her dissertation focuses on 18th century Korean and Chinese art, and today her paper will look at Chaekgeori and its development to examine the terminology, categories, and historiographic framework of Korean paintings. And our final presenter is Dr. Byungmo Chung, professor of cultural heritage at Gyeongju University in Korea. He got his PhD from Dongguk University in Seoul, Korea, and he is an expert on Korean genre painting and folk painting. And he's also the other co-organizer of this traveling exhibition, also co-editor of the catalog, beautiful catalog. And his title of the paper is The Mystical Allure of Folk Style Chaekgeori. And final announcement, the beautiful exhibition catalog is available at the front desk for sale for you. So don't forget while you're out. And let's welcome our panelists, Dr. Kim.
Thank you, Jenny, for a very kind introduction. And this has been very enlightening symposium for me. I'd like to start right away. In my previous study of Chaekgeori screen, I focused primarily on large-scale bookshelf-style Chaekgado. I examined how patrons or owners attempted to craft their social and cultural identities through carefully selected symbolic objects or possibly collected or possessed objects. However, in this presentation, I would like to shift my attention from Chaekgeori patrons to Chaekgeori painters and productions. The goal is to explore how artists produce the minhwa or folk-style Chaekgeori screens. And my study is preliminary and thus far based largely on observations, as there is no, not that I know of, written text on the involved procedures. This new study is ongoing work in collaboration with Dr. Chung Do-hee, who is a professor at Yongnam University and a painter who has expertise in traditional painting methods. She has provided me with a valuable advice and suggestions relative to technical terms and other matters. But we just started it like a few weeks ago, so I have more questions than answers. Shortly after the promotion of bookshelf-style Chaekgeado screen by King Jeongjo in the late 18th century, both the Yangban, or aristocrats, and wealthy Chungin, or technical officers, came to have Chaekgeori screens in their homes. Not long afterwards, Chaekgeori screens became very popular household decorations among prosperous commoners as well as Yangban and Chungin. Although Yangban home traditionally featured monochrome literary painting, the Yangban Igyu Sang observed that by the late 18th century, no Yangban house was not decorated with colorful Chaekgeori paintings. About 70 years later, the Chungin Yu Jaegeon wrote much the same regarding the Chungin and other well-to-do, and noted that he had a Chaekgeori in his own home. And this shows the expanded consumption of Chaekgeori painting in society. As Chaekgeori became popular among commoners, the paintings changed in size, form, content, and style. As we have seen in earlier presentations, the Chaekgeori screen paintings produced for the elite and court by court painters or former were structured on a bookshelf framework and contained mostly books and other luxury imports. They were expensive and were commissioned and personalized for their patrons. As Chaekgeori became popular with and spread out to more people, including wealthy commoners, they took on a different form, more likely Western still lifes, and without the shelf structure. Although they were also usually grouped in screens, they were smaller to fit modest house. These paintings were brightly colored and mass-produced. They were not as personalized as the more expensive bookshelf type, but were commodified for the mass markets. Therefore, we may take both their aesthetic form and their symbolism to reflect the taste and desires of a large segment of the buying market. This is to say, a significant number of people with a disposable income but no literary pretensions wanted to buy paintings in a brand new style full of sumptuous imagery of successful and lavish lifestyles. The Chaekgeori screens produced for the public differed in many ways from the screen at court. First, they became much smaller in size. While bookshelf Chaekgeori screens are around 51 inches tall and 130 inches wide, the Minhwa Chaekgeori screens are around 25 inches tall and 95 inches wide. And second, as size was reduced, the former multi-shelved bookshelf format disappeared. While bookshelf-style Chaekgeori screens have books and other objects in structured shelves on a continuous screen format, in Minhwa Chaekgeori, objects are placed on a small desk or on the floor, and books are stacked on top of small tables. Third, exotic luxurious foreign imports were replaced by Korean indigenous objects. European clocks were not seen, and Qing Chinese overglazed or enamel porcelains were replaced by more humble porcelains. Native fruits and vegetables like watermelon, Korean melons, peaches, grapes, cucumbers, and eggplants took the place. Likewise, more familiar flowers like peonies, flowering plum, and lotus replaced imported flowers like narcissus. And small items of furniture like medicine chest and a small reading desk appeared, as did feminine objects. So many of you asked about feminine objects. So if you look at these paintings, we see some of the women's shoes and the perfume containers. And I cannot really see. And this one doesn't really have any kind of physical evidence, but from the stylistic and color choices, I kind of tend to think this is for a woman more like. As did the feminine objects like women's shoes, hats, silver knives, and perfume containers, along with the leisure game objects like corpet tiles. Lastly, if artists attempted to recreate reality for bookshelf-style Chaekgeori screens through modeling and linear perspective, painters of tabletop Chaekgeori try to create fantasy through both bright and whimsical style and the addition of auspicious and symbolic animals like cranes, mandarin ducks, dragons, giraffes, and deer with horns. There are no written documents providing a clear idea of how folk-style Chaekgeori screens were made. Nonetheless, by observing extant screens, we may speculate about the means of their productions. Multi-panel folk Chaekgeori screens with their jumbled cornucopia of objects, bright colors, and varied and complicated patterns on bookcases, and distinct wood patterns on desks amaze viewers with their unique and dazzling displays of splendor and diversity. However, if we look at carefully and compare the images panel by panel, we soon discern striking similarities in objects and compositions and come to realize that many of the screens were ready-made or mass-produced, probably from available templates or chobon at artist workshops. So, for example, these 8-panel Chaekgeori screens from the Gyeonggi Provincial Museum and Sunmun University Museum look different at first, mainly due to the use of different palettes. While the contrasting red and green or blue color of the bookcase is most noticeable on the Sunmun screen below, and the painter of the Gyeonggi Provincial Museum screen decorated the bookcases with various patterns, and there are no distinctive colors on the screen. Also, the order of the panel is different. Therefore, viewers might not initially notice their similarities. For more direct and easier comparison, I have changed the order of some panels in the Sunmun Chaekgeori screen. Now, we see that these two screens, in fact, have almost identical compositions and inclusive objects, except the third one from the right. It is therefore possible to say that the painters of these two screens probably used the same chobon or templates. There are, in fact, a number of Chaekgeori panels with similar compositions. For example, these 5 panels from different Chaekgeori screens have the same core images of rabbit figurines, and we will come back to this. This one. We know that the great numbers of art manuals and pattern books were imported from China during the late Joseon period. As Soo-ah showed the 10 bamboo studio painting manuals. This was the most common means by which Korean artists became acquainted with the latest artistic fashions and techniques of presentations. These books contained templates for all kinds of objects and compositions which were used by artists for both Minhwa Chaekgeori and many individuals' objects depicted in bookshelf Chaekgeori. However, in addition to copying from manuals, today's presentation, some of Professor Bang Byung-sun also pointed out that it is possible that artists also drew from actual objects. We don't have any evidence about this for now. However, the artist would trace over chobon to create underdrawings on the very thin translucent papers or silk on which the paintings were done. And this paper was later mounted on thicker paper or other backings to provide the strength. This is the traditional Korean method of finishing paintings on paper or silk. So we may assume or at least speculate that Chaekgeori artists used the same techniques. And fortunately, we also have a few extant chobon that tell us about the production of Chaekgeori screens. In particular, we have already Professor Jungman have introduced us this Mattielli collections, the chobon, 8 drawings. now in at the University of Oregon. And this provide valuable information. These drawings are now labeled at A to H in Oregon Museum. However, if we look at each drawing, there is a number of Chinese characters at the lower right corner of each paper, which allow us to place them in traditional order. So I kind of put them in order. The eighth, and the eighth drawing has a record of the production date. Okay. Which is the 9th day of the 10th month in the year of Imshin. And the year of Imshin could be either 1872 during the late Joseon dynasty or 1932, but it's probably the latter, as we shall see later. This also, it has the it says like it was copied at the Gongdong, which is modern day Sogongdong, the village. And this chobon is drawn with ink on paper, and the color as well as the painting technique is written on each object. A painter must have placed either thin paper over these drawings and traced the outlines. So far, color analysis of the cold cell chaekgeori screen has been done through X-ray fluorescence. The procedure allows an educated guess as to the kind of pigments used and their ingredients. However, the chobon records actual pigment names, thereby telling us the precise pigments used or at least suggested by whoever visualized the composition, which apparently would be painted in later, probably by another painter. If you look at the chobon drawings, we can tell they were done rather quickly, and then a few patterns and motifs were drawn as examples, with the color and techniques written next to them. It appears the painter used his own aesthetic taste and capacities to color and decorate the details. Also, the painter could have used different pigments to complete the paintings. During the late Joseon period, there were various pigments for one color. For example, the color red could be produced from cinnabar, vermilion, eosin, carmine, rouge, scarlet, or dark red. So for the colors of chaekgeori screens, painters used mainly the five colors or obangsaek, which is also related to the directions and also cardinal animals in from the traditional East Asia. Obangsaek that are red, yellow, blue, or green, black, and white. Their pigments would usually be in the form of powder or cake made of either natural plants or minerals. A water-based glue would be added as a binder so that the colors would stick to the paper or silk. Just as with the most modern Western watercolors, which are so often come in cakes, the chaekgeori artist could mix the paint as thin or thick as he wanted. So there are many different hues of each color in chaekgeori screens created from different ingredients. So blues are usually from azurite, but even so, it comes in four shades, dark to light. And in the late 19th century, synthetic blue called yangcheong was introduced and was widely used by Korean painters in the first half of the 20th century. This synthetic blue is bright, crystalline, and as we see here, yangcheong. Yeah, and I see some of this yangcheong, the Western blue, on the some of the paintings out there, the screens. So if we look at the names of the colors written on drawings, we see about 15 main colors specified, including and also green. Including Ju red, Huang yellow, Ji rouse, Yuk red, Cheng blue, Yicheng dark blue, Samcheng light blue, Nok green, Ha leafy green, Jinmuk dark and thick Indian ink, Sumuk waterly Indian ink, Boon White, Beck White, Hue Gray, Kim Gold, and five mixed colors, which I kind of made a diagram. The painter used simplified Chinese characters or homonyms to write the names of colors in order to fit them into the limited space. So for example, the painter wrote simply Ji instead of the full name Yeonji for the color of rose. And for the color of green, the painter used an abbreviations, as we see over there. Nope. And for the different brightness of the blue pigments, the painter just identified them by number and omitted the word blue. For the color of white, the painter used the name Bun and Baek. Bun is a white pigment made of lead, while Baek is a pigment made of white kaolin. And according to Dr. Jung Do-hee, in traditional Korean paintings, white from kaolin was used during and after the period of the Korean Empire, which is from 1897 to 1910. And thus, this chobon is likely to be from 1932 rather than 1872. And if we look at the drawings carefully, we see that the painter used the character Bun for Bunjeom or Bunmun or Cheongbunbon. In other words, Bun, white, Jeom, dotting, means make dots with white color, and Bun, white, Mun, motifs and patterns, means that decorate with white, and Cheongbunbon, which means blue, white, and coloring, bone means coloring, means mix blue with white and color the area. On the other hand, Baek was used to color the area in white. If the area is needed to be left empty or uncolored, the painter used the character Gong, meaning empty. In addition to the colors, the underdrawing, this Chobon showed about 9 different painting techniques. Those include Bon, Mun, Hui, Shim, Ban, Banmun, Huek, Jeom, Hwa, and Gong. For example, and I also kind of tried to find the techniques that they used for this Matielli Chobon. For example, Bon means solid coloring and Mun means decorate with patterns. Very often, instructions for color and techniques are combined together, like Ju Bon, Huang Bun, which means Ju red, Bon coloring, Huang, yellow mixed with white, Huangbun, and Mun, meaning color this in red and decorate with the patterns in the mixed colors of yellow and white. Likewise, Jeom Hwa means dotting and painting flowers. Hui means gradations, and if it says Byeon Ji Hwa, which means boundary, grouse, and gradation, then it means give a gradation in rouse at the border. Shim means emphasize that part with the thick colors. If the word shim is combined with the name of color, it means to emphasize that part with the named color. Banmun indicates the more complicated Chinese characters, which means wave patterns. These wave patterns are often specified for the surfaces of wooden furniture, as we see here. So apparently, the word was used to indicate curvy organic wood grains, which was a favorite texture for Minhwa Chaekgeori's artist. Through these Chobon drawings, then we can see how artists were instructed to use colors and patterns to produce paintings. But who wrote the instructions? Were they an artist's notes to himself? Or were they notes for other studio painters who would fill in the underwritings, under drawings? Those are among many questions remaining to be answered. While the tabletop Chaekgeori painting painters did not leave their names on their paintings, they appear to have developed their own recognizable patterns or particular ways of drawing or painting animals. Therefore, after observing numerous folk style or Minhwa Chaekgeori screens, one can even find the characteristic feature of a painter. That table Chaekgeori painters worked closely from Chobon becomes clear when compared several relevant paintings. Panels we found earlier, that we saw earlier. We see common features in these five paintings: a highly decorative carved stand and ornate base bearing a flowering plum branch, two melons on a dish, a wine bottle with a cup over it on a tabletop, rabbit figurine placed on three stacks of books, and an opened box below the table. Even though these elements are colored differently, it is obvious the painters used the same templates. However, in the right one, the painter added a bow in a bow case and an arrow holders. And I am, again, kind of my hypothesis is that the patron kind of made special request to include those objects. That patron of this Chaekgeori screen might have been a military man who proudly indicates his personal identity with a bow and arrow. Numerous Chaekgeori screens attest that the artist used such as this chobun or templates very often, and also have added and one or two objects painted from life, perhaps from buyer's collection upon his or her request. In another pair of paintings, the artist used the chobun in reverse, so that the depicted objects are exactly the same, but from mirror images. The intermingling of reality and abstract takes many forms in Chaekgeori paintings. For example, tabletop Chaekgeori artists freely adopted diverse perspective depicting objects. Artists often increased the size of distant objects so that the viewers could see them better, which is typical in all kinds of Korean paintings. In order to represent an object completely, the artist might show different parts thereof simultaneously, similar to Western analytical cubism, in which the artist depicts one object from a multitude of viewpoints. For example, here, in this screen, I think it's the third one, where the ink stick is half standing as if it is in use. And in contrast to the static formality of bookshelf Chaekgeori, tabletop Chaekgeori attracted their viewers through bright colors, rich sensuality, and auspicious symbolism. Their compositions are typically less restrained, more cluttered, and more dynamic than the bookshelf Chaekgeori, which are stabilized and grounded by their horizon and vertical lines. Without the shelf format to provide, geometric spatial structures, tabletop Chaekgeori do not create consistent space. Instead, they usually give each object its own perspective and do not reduce the size of objects in the background. The effect is that of a jumble of objects piled on top of each other rather than receding in space. Although this jumble of objects usually floats in the center of the blank background, many of the involved artists shrank the negative space until there was almost no space between objects in the background and little around the edges. In many cases, the artist employs so much pattern in contrast to real space that the scene devolved into little more than a maze of geometric motifs and colorful patterns reflecting an aesthetic that bear no resemblance either to realism or to any traditional Korean painting. In any case, the objects and backgrounds intertwine in delightful shapes, confusing the eye, blurring the distinction between positive and negative space, and shifting the focus from three-dimensional objects to surface interplay of texture, pattern, and design. Chaekgeori painters explored and played freely with the surface for the sheer visual pleasure of the viewer, and in so doing, created a unique and intriguing form of Korean art. Thank you.
Apologize, I lost my voice from allergies. Actually, the warm, humid weather the last couple of days has actually helped, but it's still a little froggy, so I apologize for that. if you can't hear me, just wave or something. The other thing is I wanted to really thank the organizers. As somebody who's always wanted to study Korean art history in the United States, it is really a fascinating conference to have here, and it's a testament to the pioneering works of Professor Jungmann and Professor Haufler and their commitment and really how much has developed over these last 15 to 20 years to have this kind of conference where Korean subject is at the center and we're having these really great, interesting, cross-cultural, global, from all scholars from all over. This wouldn't have happened 15 years ago. So I'm really honored to be here. And knowing that there'd be so many other distinguishing scholars here and would be providing specific and important insights into Chaekgeori iconography and style and production and consumption. And you've heard them all today. Incredible papers, foreign influence, archival and literary materials. I did find myself at a loss in choosing a topic for today that wouldn't be repetitive or a bit reductive. And truthfully, when I saw who would be attending and presenting, I wanted to pull out and not come because I was afraid. But I'm here, I didn't chicken out, and I'm here. And as the title of this presentation hints at with the play on words, I decided to take the discussion in a slightly different direction, although with things that we've been all talking about or phrases that we've been using throughout the whole day. And to use this opportunity to talk about categories and terms that I often struggle with when it comes to paintings like Chaekgeori. This talk will be polemical in nature and raise questions without attempting to answer them, but I hope it will be a thought experiment in the implications and limitations of terminology and categories that Chaekgeori studies can particularly shed a light on. I begin with this terrible image of a Chaekgeori as it is arguably the painting that initiated modern Chaekgeori studies. Many of you will recognize this as the painting that Kay Black found in the East Asian Library at Columbia University. And as this image illustrates, it was found as a set of hanging scrolls. This painting was the source and starting point for Kay Black's two seminal articles in the early 1990s that introduced Chaekgeori paintings to a Western audience for sure, if not put the spotlight on Chaekgeori for Korean scholars as well. The paintings were sold to the Asian Art Museum San Francisco, where they are now, and remounted to its original format of a folding screen. So you see that on the bottom. Not only did Kay Black, in collaboration with Edward Wagner, bring to light a painting genre that had not been readily known, but the discovery of the painter's name, Byungmo, clearly incorporated into the painting on the base of his seal and an identifying E as a 19th century court painter, launched a reexamination of all Chaekgeori paintings, resulting in the identification of about two dozen sign works by a few different painters. Soon after these discoveries, in 2001, a two-volume publication by Kang Kwang-sik on late chosen court painters was a groundbreaking investigation into the venerable records of Joseon, or Joseon Wonjo Shilok, about the court painting system and court painters. With that and subsequent scholarship, the term Gungjunghwa, court painting, became a categorical term. Yet, as Professor Jungmann mentioned in her keynote yesterday, Gungjunghwa is not confined to paintings that were produced at and for the court and is applied to a larger subset of paintings, since many, if not all, court painters freelance and paint in commissions for non-court individuals. This then begs the questions, what are the determining factors of labeling a painting a court painting? Does it have to be made by a court painter? If so, then we are left with a very small number of identifiable court paintings, as most court painters did not sign their works. Signed Chaekgeori are definitely more the exception than the rule. Then, is it based on style? Or more specifically, skillfulness? If so, then the Chaekgeori on the bottom, I'm viewing the exhibition here, by an anonymous painter with its similarities to the one above, the eunuch one, would be a court painting or in the court painting style. But what of the other Chaekgeori on view in the exhibition? Though inspired, obviously, by a bookcase type, the compositional type that most scholars assume originated by court painters at the request or initiative of the king would, in its stylistic rendering, be deemed a court painting. Probably not. Okay, the X is overly dramatic. But if not a court painting, then would it be categorized by the other term that has been frequently used throughout this conference, minhwa or folk painting? As terms, the opposite or counter to court would seem to be min, the people or folk. Most often, the non-bookcase type of Chaekgeori, such as these table types that we've seen throughout the day, this one is also on view in the exhibition, are referred to as minhwa. Again, what are the determining factors in labeling this kind of painting minhwa? Is it the producer, the consumer? Who are the min? Can all non-royal people be grouped together as min? If it is skill, this screen is carefully and skillfully painted. Each panel contains objects that have been thoughtfully positioned and composed, and the details on each object, such as the automaton figure at the bottom, the ribbing on the fan in the center, the decorative painting patterns of the rolled papers, are delicately and precisely painted. If you haven't taken a close look at that one in the gallery, I would recommend it because it is really wonderfully painted. So is this a folk painting? So what is folk painting as a term? We all know with terms, nothing is straightforward, particularly when the translation of min is the word folk. Though in the recent past, there has been scholarship that pushes back on the negative and derogatory connotations that are associated with folk, such as unskilled and primitive, it is important to examine the manner in which the term minhwa or folk came about and was implemented. Like most usages of folk, it came about to indicate hierarchy, and for Korea, as well as many other locations and cultures, within a colonial environment during the early 20th century. Again, this will be a review for most in this room, but I think it's a necessary reminder. Minhwa is the offshoot from the Japanese concept of minge, often translated as folk craft or folk art, that was formulated and propagated by Japanese intellectuals and artisans in the early 20th century. Minge is commonly thought to be the brainchild of Yanagi Muneyoshi. As Kim Brandt's scholarship reveals, chosen art was the impetus for Yanagi's theories on minge aesthetics. And anecdotes mark Yanagi's encounter with this chosen blue and white jar in this upper right in 1914, presented to him by Asakaga Nortaka as the starting point for Yanagi's interest in chosen ceramics, in particular, and in chosen art more generally. Thus, Yanagi's concept of minge was not only introduced to Korea in the 20th century, but it was Korean ceramics, specifically, that was the stimulus for Yanagi's theories. Again, as Kim Brandt's work shows, along with the recent growing field of research on the colonial period in the last 5 to 8 years, minge aesthetics and its usage cannot be separated from the colonial politics of the 20th century. This excerpt from Asakaga's poem Subo reflects the Japanese minge movement's intellectual stance toward Korean art. Koreans do not know what intention is. Rather than self-consciousness and reflection, they have one instinctive way. They make things with the pure heart of a child drawing a picture, and that one feeling continues to the end. An art in which feeling rather than rationality has won. An art in which the same thing cannot be made twice. Children's work made by adults. One bows the head on seeing the drawings of children and feels astonished shame of one's own impurity. And British potter Bernard Leach, father of the studio pottery movement in Europe or in England, who was a follower of Yanagi and the Minge movement, came to Seoul in 1930, purchased a moon jar, now one of the star objects of the British Museum, I wouldn't give it up for the world, expressed, "The Koreans and their pots are childlike, spontaneous and trusting. We had something akin to this in Europe up to about the 13th century." I don't know about you, but I cringe at the sort of patronizing, reductive sentiment that is couched in these words of praise, childlike, thus not mature or accomplished, instinctive, not thoughtful and intellectual. And as many of you will recognize, these are the terms that are often used to justify colonial practices and the civilizing of primitives. The nostalgia sentiment in these statements often stem from the loss of traditions in the face of modernity, but yet again, reinforcing the primitive-modernity dichotomy. And in this case, it's not only the colonial practices of Japan, but that these practices are within a larger global context of Western imperialism. In these binaries, the center-periphery relationships with regard to modernity, it is Japan implementing Western imperialistic practices, which was at the center, to Asia, and thus places itself, Japan, at the center. Again, most of you know of these pitfalls and the long shadows of colonialism, and thus, there is the emergence of alternative modernities. But back to Chaekgeori. Chaekgeori and its rediscovery in the late 20th century has made me ponder two questions. The first is, why does the term minhwa persist and is still commonly used for paintings, but min-e, which is the Korean pronunciation for minge, is not used for ceramics or decorative arts? Or if min-e is used, it is much less frequent or common. Even in English translations, the term folk has been dropped, and craft or decorative arts is more commonly used for ceramics, metalwork, woodwork, tile, textiles, etc. In a few weeks' time, in London, there will be the annual London Craft Week. And no one today would think to call it the London Folk Craft Week or the London Folk Art Week. In Korean, the term today that is more commonly used is konghae. Yet minhwa is still used for paintings. Does the continued use of minhwa actually reveal our hierarchies and biases in the field of art history today, and perhaps more so in the US, with the divisions by media and material and the privilegings of paintings? I won't delve into this because that will lead us into another rabbit hole, but perhaps worth contemplating for later. Moving to my second question is, why did it take till the 1990s for Chaekgeori to receive attention? These incredible paintings are striking and unique, as you've all seen today, and seem to be perfect candidates for scholarship and for introducing a Korean painting genre to an unknown public. Yet they were long overlooked. There are likely many reasons for this, but I would bring forth today that their classification as minhwa and the derogatory and colonial baggage that came with the term was a factor. But as stated earlier, Kungjunghwa was a term that came about in the late 1990s, early 2000s. Thus, before the term Kungjunghwa, even paintings that were known to be made solely for the king, like the sun, moon, and five peak screens, were called minhwa by researchers and scholars in the 1970s and 1980s. If the various and numerous paintings of Chaekgeori that we've seen today could run the gamut of the court to minhwa style spectrum, the sun, moon, and five peak screens are the representative type of court painting, only made by court painters, only for the king, to act as even the pictorial stand-in for the king. This is as court-centric painting as a painting can get. And as far away from the meaning of min or people or folk, either in the Habermasian or Marxist sense, yet it was still called minhwa. Why? How? Is it the style? All the natural elements are pared down to their most essential forms and are rendered in flat graphic style. Did later 20th century scholars think this style perhaps unnatural, weak in representation, to be folkish with its negative tones? If that is so, then bookcase Chaekgeori would be the opposite example, with its incorporation of perspectival and shading techniques and a commitment to representation of objects. Yet, but both Chaekgeori and the Sun, Moon, Five Peaks were categorized as folk paintings. Hence, there is another standard that these paintings are being compared to that has not yet come up in this talk, but was brought up in Professor Haufler's talk that cannot be ignored, and that is Muninhwa, or literati painting. And Chris mentioned this earlier in the opening remarks about this dichotomy between color or polychrome painting versus ink painting, and that was one of the reasons or the interest in organizing an exhibition on these colorful paintings. The status and influence, and I use influence with its hierarchical and limiting connotations, of the literati is indisputable in any Confucian society, and the chosen people were always striving to be their utmost Confucian, at the very least, in theory and in rhetoric, if not in reality. Thus, the central stance of literati painting, comprised of calligraphy and ink painting, is not surprising in Joseon. Polychrome paintings were compared to and judged against literati painting, and in the 20th century were lumped together and called minhwa. Yet while the Japanese Minge movement and colonial situation of the early 20th century played a role in the creation of these categories and terms, I would also say that some of the biases and misnomers persisted in the second half of the 20th century due to nationalistic practices of scholars. Whether knowingly or unknowingly, I think that the pioneering scholars of the 1970s and 80s who established Korean art history as a modern discipline were influenced by the colonial sentiments stated in the earlier quotes, Korean art having been defined as childlike, not having intention or rationale, would have driven many to rescue it from its patronizing and condescending view. And thus, it's not surprising that many of the early modern scholars turned to literati painting that could irrefutably illustrate erudition, rationale, intentionality, agency, and skill. The other factor to keep in mind is that many of these early scholars received their training in U.S. universities, predominantly advised and mentored by Chinese art history professors. And we know that in the 1970s and 80s, much of Chinese art history was focused on Chinese literati painting. With this desire to rescue Korean painting from obscurity or prejudicial comparisons to Japanese and Chinese paintings, and from the limiting discussion of influence that Professor Byungmo clearly spoke of yesterday that still persists today, it is again not surprising that the next two types of paintings that were researched and introduced to the wider public for Korean painting is true view landscape painting and genre paintings, arguably the most Korean of paintings, and where the Koreanness of these paintings is again obvious and undeniable. Ironically, the Kimongdo genre paintings, one of the most famous here, is depicting the people, the folks. Yet we don't refer to it as folk painting, but we refer to it as punsokwa, or genre paintings. Thus, the semi-arbitrariness of the terms used to categorize paintings and painters can be illustrated in briefly looking at Kimongdo. Here are just a few extant works that Kim painted or collaborated on that we know of. Kim is arguably the most popular and praised painter of his time in the 18th century. He worked for the court. He worked for commissions for anyone who could afford him. He worked for himself. And the numerous archival records refer to his genius and ability to paint in all styles and genres. And we have records that he even painted and was adept at painting Chaekgeori. There are no extant paintings of Chaekgeori that we can attribute to him, though. So how does one categorize a painter like Kim and his work? I didn't mean to do a deep dive into historiography, but it is important to try to tease out the various influences in the past and our own biases in the present that form many of the categories and the terms that we are wedded to today. Now turning back to Chaekgeori and my struggle that I mentioned at the start of this talk. Now having rambled on about the difficulties and the less than perfect fit of categories and terms, I wonder how to deal with these paintings. Those shown here are all in the exhibition that have some common features and have vastly different ones. I'm not calling for a doing away with terms, as that is impractical, and that we all need to grapple with language in conveying ideas and interpretations and theories. But I am reminded, and perhaps this is more in an exercise of reminding myself, that terms and categories need to be dealt with thoughtfully. In thinking about the rigidity of classification, I was once again reminded that real life is never neat and tidy. And the time period that brought about the emergence of Chaekgeori and its flourishing was a time chosen that was stable politically, but changing socioeconomically, with merchants and Chungin class gaining more status and power, with Yangban and the elite easily falling from grace. It wasn't neat and tidy then, so I should allow for more fluidity and messiness in the terms themselves and the uses of them now. There were most likely courtly courts, courtly folks, folksy courts, folksy folks, that all interacted with Chaekgeori. And so we should try to embrace and think about it in a wider sense. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris and Chung Shin Lee, for inviting me. This is final talk today. There is a saying in Korea, bright beginning and dull finish. William Shakespeare said this, also well, that finish well. I will try to be well finished rather than a dull finish. In the 1959, the curious folk painting of Joseon, Yanagi Muneyoshi wrote about the two-panel folk-style Chaekgeori screen, as you can read on the screen. Sorry, you can read on the screen. Through this article, the value of beauty of folk painting, or Mina, was introduced to the world. Yanagi disciple and textile designer Serizawa Keisuke would go on to say, quote, I have seen many beautiful works of art, but Joseon still life paintings struck me the most forcefully. For a few moments, everything around me faded away as I was drawn into this irresistible painting. I found the scene surprisingly alluring and was overjoyed, end quote. From now on, I'll talk about Chaekgeori was painting genre enjoyed not only in the court but also among commoners. Chaekgeori originally produced in the court were adapted by the common folk and became known as Minha Chaekgeori. While Chaekgeori of court are strictly formal and focused on faithful depiction, Minha Chaekgeori unfold a colorful world brimming with imagination. From now on, I'll talk further alluring and imaginative world of Minha Chaekgeori is. Commoner's view on book differed from those of nobility. To commoners, the book was a symbol of realistic success and the means of achieving it. Gyeongju's mat waving depicts the people's attitude toward the books. In the painting, the father waves mat, the mother spins thread, and the son reads a book rather than himself. That father who is wearing a hat, indicating noble class, is doing manual labor like a commoner, make it clear that he failed to obtain the governor's post. In other words, the son is exempt from household labor because he must study, pass the civil service exam, and restore himself and the family to his former glory. This Chaekgeori is a quintessential example of this transformation. In spite of works genre as painting of a book, the watermelon featured prominently at the center of the image symbolized the change. The book are relegated to the background with fruits and flowers, including not only the watermelon, but also lotus, flowers, and peaches. Peaches taking center stage. This piece shows how emphasized the reversed. The plants and the fruits that have taken off the book's place in the spotlight. Spotlight are auspicious symbols for a happy life. The flower, the watermelons represent fertility. The kingfishers pecking at the lotus denote passing the civil service exams, and the peaches signify longevity. Having become symbols of happiness, Minha Chaekgeori were also space for eroticism. Eroticism serving a fundamental human desire. Chaekgeori in the collection the Musée Guimet in Paris depicts symbols of femininity on the upper selves. Such as ginkgo fruits and sewing tools. The bottom or right show a man's shoes and accoutrement. Okay, bedding and pillow are laid out on the platform in the middle, and the men's and the women's clothing on the scattered haphazardly upon it, as if cast away in a hurry. Something is taking place on the left. This is erratic work. The erraticism suggested by the object the bedding and the clothes demonstrate the height of Korean metaphorical usage. Joseon era studies were the exclusive domain of men. There are real examples of paintings of women's study. Above these items is ceramic and article tailored to the female preference. Beneath them rest a woman's silk slipper and perfume bottles. The watermelon are roughly pieced by a decorative knife. Elicit macabre feeling. Watermelons symbolize the bearing of many sons because of the fruit seed. In Mast Mina, this meaning conveyed by the genteel slicing off of the top of the watermelon, thus revealing of seeds inside. In this instance, would you central image of a beautiful painting be the subject of ghoulish stabbing? Perhaps the commissioner of the painting may wish to cry out this message. I am not a child boss machine. Okay. The space depicted the Minha Chaekgeori do not abide by science or common sense of logic. Articles are placed in a natural way. Books and accoutrements float in the air, and the colors and the pattern used does not correspond to reality. Well, real painters look at the bookshelf and painted it as seen, Minha Chaekgeori reflect the artist's taste. For example, without exemption, court style Chaekgeori invoked Western linear perspective and shading technique, while Minha Chaekgeori employed the traditional Eastern inverse perspective or multiple viewpoints. This is like ingesting a Western steak, versus being driven through the savory luscious Korean food such as doenjang or kimchi. Minha Chaekgeori folding screens are about one quarter to one third the height of those used in the court. Okay, this guy is me, much younger than thou. Since the space commoners lived in the inn was small, the folding screens by necessity were also small. Would the impressive impact of Chaekgeori painting be lessened with this reduction in size? Minha artists became carefully assembled books and personal items within the smaller frame or paintings, drawing them very close together. As if in a single mass. This contraction of space between objects led to more of a two-dimensional effect, or sometimes cross between 2D or 3D, thus creating an abstract image. Like stuffing many items into small wrapping cloth pottery, Minha Chaekgeori painting presents a sense of life of wisdom compressed into a tiny space. Similar to ancient tomb murals from Goguryeo, scale in Minha was determined by the importance of the subject featured in the work. Independent of actual size, important object were drawn larger than the others. This Chaekgeori is a combination of Chaekgeori and the portrait that seems reminiscent Gulliver's Travels, a Lilliputian child, smaller than Bo, reading his own book in front of the table for Buddhist text. The boy is reading Soo-ah, an ethic textbook for Joseon era children. The fact that the boy in the painting is smaller than books indicates that though he is a person, he is peripheral to painting. While the this screen small, the composition placed books at the center and managed to peg in a boy octomont and plants around the revered books. Over the time, Mina Chaekgeori became flatter and more abstract. This Chaekgeori with Chinese letter is also the reminiscent of the abstract works of French painter Henri Matisse in his two-dimensional composition. As shown in the flat and geometric covered books. Surprisingly, this very modern painting was done a rural Mina painter Hwang Sung-gyu, active in the early 20th century. I once visited his house and grave and had a big bow. Painting flat space with abstract appearance is the tradition in Korean visual art. However, this two-dimensionality does not indeed define a deficient technique or screen skill. This style demonstrates the preference of traditional Korean artists, as can be seen in the to the lover's perspective. In Buddhist painting from the Goguryeo dynasty, portrait of King Taejo was painted in flat style, as seen in planar depiction of king's seat and the footstool. Some Mina Chaekgeori, however, incorporate bookshelves like those of court style. Shorter folding screen limited in the space available, but a small canvas is not a problem. A problem in the hands of the imaginative artist. The Chaekgeori from Mizu Gime is an example of a work where imagination runs free, even in the limited frame of bookshelves that are so restricted in the court. This work, relatively smaller at only 77 centimeters in height, but it presents a successful composition of bookshelves. In spite of their size, they serve as a home to vast and endless world of imagination. Some of the covered books are not shown in their entirety, implied through glimpses and vast hover between selves freely. The most surprising features is the shelf filled with the water, with two dogs playing in the init. This painting is a testament to the artist's endless imagination. Chaekgeori and Munjado are different from genre, but blend well together because they are both centered on academics. Munjado is ideographs or letter painting representing confusion, virtues or blessings. The Shinjado is an example in which Chaekgeori is incorporated in ideographs. Though the painting itself, on ideograph, the stroke that compose the character are made of books. In addition, the book depict only a flat pattern on them. The second and the third stroke of a character scene are composed of a book standing upright and laid sideways respectfully. Shin-chad show how freely genre were mixed in Mina painting. Among works that display blending of genres, however, only Minha is the imagination so fantastical as to mix bookshelves with auspicious creatures. Imagine how the simplicity of the scholar's study changes when dragonflies, lion roars, giraffe walk about, and two deers make love. The scene is reminiscent of Disney animation, yet this kind of success is not uncommon in Minha with cosmic imagination. The museum collection include a work, There's a Cross, between Chaekgeori and the painting of auspicious beast. The upper part of the folding screen is Chaekgeori, while the bottom part is auspicious painting with both genres in one image. Between the two jets of fantastic check the mountain range, in the midst of everything, Chaekgeori float of the landscape like UFOs. It is arbitrage, a combination possible in the Minha. The Chaekgeori part of the painting is also curious with vases floating above the book, showing how even realistic and mundane object and scenes can be used to express fantastic world. The most masterful cross between Chaekgeori and auspicious beast is found in Chaekgeori at the Joseon Minha Museum. The dragon and the toad are wrapped around the book. The antenna of the dragon and the toad are connected, implying a relationship between the two. Dreams of dragon or toad have traditional Hawaiian omens of giving birth to son. Which means that this particular imagery is a symbol of fertility. The books symbolize the excellent academically and the success in life. These features show that this work is infused with the hopes of giving birth to many sons and last of study and successfully entering the University of Kansas. Although the desire represented in Minha Chaekgeori were very real, they were expressed in metaphorical, lyrical, fantastical manner. A certain auspicious energy is found in these paintings, and like express fragment bridge, there is a spirit and taste that can only found in Minha. Thus, rather than accepting Chaekgeori as a realistic world, people recognized it as a fanciful space hovering between the real and the ideal. In Minha, reality and fantasy, they cannot be combined in life, are brought together in harmony. There is no border between the two worlds. This painting suggests that belief that utopia is no longer a far distant place, but is right here by our side. In Mina, Chaekgeori is reality is like dream, and dreams are reality. Thank you very much.